I like the new cups.
You like those?
I do.
That's a sweet little ministry. So I asked them if we could get their cups and advertise for them.
Okay, you're on, Dale.
We're good. Okay. Well, today we're going to look at the second lesson that we're going to do on our mission trip. It's the title of this is How to Be Filled with the Spirit. How to Be Filled with the Holy Spirit. Is this working for us?
We're going to give it a whirl.
How long does that take?
Well, I think it'd go by you.
Come on, brother.
It's got power.
Let's go around.
Go ahead and try to hit the hits. It should be going. Oh, there we go. It is up there. It's just now powering up. And by the way,
maybe we should turn off the lights.
Yeah. And Dale, at some point, I'll try to put this online so people can see it.
That looks good.
Is that okay? I don't know what the rest of that is.
Okay, guys. Lesson two. Why don't we open up with prayer? Because I'm going to tell the people that are going to be at these conferences that if you get this, everything falls into place. That's how important it is. This is central. This is foundational to everything else you're going to learn, because with this, you're going to be able to do or respond properly with whatever else you learn. So this is the importance of this lesson can't be overstated. Father, I do thank you for the privilege of just being together, opening up your word, and seeking how it is that you provided resources and how those resources can be accessed and displayed in our lives as we walk with you. That's what we want, Father. We want to attract people with the attractiveness of the life of Christ because of our experience of him. We want to draw people to him. Thank you for what you're going to do in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So what we have, as we, let's see, I'm still getting used to this myself. As we open up, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. Who is the Holy Spirit? Okay, now we're not going to go into depth because that we don't want to get we don't want to get bogged down in the details. It is important to understand, first of all, that he's a person. By that we mean he has the aspects of personality. He has a mind. 1 Corinthians 12:11 says he distributes spiritual gifts just as he wills, talking about the Spirit of God. He has a mind. 1 Corinthians 2:11 says he knows the deep things of God that nobody else knows. And he has emotions. Ephesians 4:30 tells us that he can be grieved. So he has a mind, emotion, and will. Secondly, according to Acts 5:3-4, and this isn't the only passage, this is just one of the clearest. Acts 5:3-4, he's called God by the Apostle Peter. How is he called God? Well, Ananias and Sapphira are not being truthful. So in these two verses, Paul says, why have you lied to God? Why have you lied to the Holy Spirit? So he all of a sudden makes the Holy Spirit, gives him the attributes of God. This can be very confusing. Most of us are confused about it. The third point is he is the third person of the Trinity. Here's the confusion. God is a triunity. Unity, there's one God. Deuteronomy 6:4-6 says, God, our God, the Lord our God, is one God. But the interesting thing is, when he uses the word one in Hebrew, that's the same word that's used in Genesis 2:24, where it says to Adam and Eve, about all people. They're going to be joined together, and the two shall become one flesh. If you're married, you know that you didn't become your wife, and your wife did not become you, but somehow there's a unity there. There's a union there. So in the same way, there are three persons in one God. Now, I'm going to leave that right there because I admit that I can't understand it. I can't explain it. And the reason I believe it is because the Word of God describes it this way. And I have to just take it at face value, by faith. He's described as a person. He's said to be God with the attributes of God. And you can find in many different passages attributes given to him. Like, if he understands the deep things of God, he's going to have omniscience. If he does things just as he wants, then he's going to have a sovereignty about him. He's called the Holy Spirit for a reason. He's really the Spirit, but he's the Holy Spirit because he has the attribute of holiness. So you can work through the scriptures and see that all the attributes that are given to God are given to the Holy Spirit. So when he calls him, describes him as somehow related to the Father and the Son, as one God, we just take that at face value. Matthew 28:19, our Bible is usually called that the Great Commission. Why that's important, why that fits here with the third person of the Trinity is you're going to baptize people in what?
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
But it's one name. He didn't say in the names of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, but in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You've got a unity and plurality together. Right when Jesus is baptized, what do you have when he's baptized? You've got the Father speaking from heaven. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. You got the Spirit coming down in the form of a dove, landing on the shoulder, and then you have Jesus. You've got all three persons involved in some way in that episode of Jesus' life. So we see these things, and we just try to describe what the Bible is saying. We don't go further. I can't explain it any further. Why did the Holy Spirit come? Well, like Jesus, there are lots of reasons why he came. But for our purposes together in this lesson, John 16:13 says, like Jesus, he came in a subordinate role. Jesus repeatedly in the book of John says, I didn't come to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. I'm not speaking my words, but the words that the Father who sent me gave me to speak. I'm doing his works, and on and on. All the way through the book of John, it's very clear that Jesus came in a subordinate role. He even describes the Father as greater than he. Well, if they're both God, no one is greater existentially or ontologically. In their being, they're equal. But when they work out their plan, they voluntarily put themselves under each other. So the Father is seen to be the one who has planned and is ordained. The Son carries out the plan, and the Holy Spirit really energizes the people to carry out the plan. So he came in a subordinate role. Why is that important? When the Holy Spirit's being talked about, if the spotlight shifts from Jesus to him, something's wrong. There shouldn't be a shift in the spotlight. I had a professor in seminary that really mentored me. He had the best illustration I've ever heard, which is normal. That's why I was drawn to him. He could say things so briefly and concisely that you just go, wow. He was talking about going to a park up in Portland, Oregon at night. And he's looking around, and on the other side of the park, he sees this tremendous statue. So he walks over toward it, and it's at nighttime. So he walks over to it, and he just admires the sculptor's ability to make such a statue. And he walks around, he reads the plaque, and he really admires the statue. And then he walks away, and the light goes on, literally. He said, "That's it." Not once did I look at the lights above the statue setting it off. The lights had a purpose of exposing the statue. The lights don't draw attention to themselves. The lights draw attention to what they're shining on. The Holy Spirit came to in a subordinate role to the very next verse, John 14, 16 says he came to glorify Jesus, not himself. He didn't come to build himself up. He didn't come to put himself on center stage. So when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, we're going to see in a moment, it's really all about Jesus. John 7, 37 to 39, he came to be the source of living water within, and that's where we're going in our time together. What is this living water? How does he refresh our soul? How does he give us a nourishment that you can't find anywhere else? And then in Acts 1:8, he came to empower us to be witnesses. Now, I want you to think about that. We usually do what we do so often is we assume. What are we assuming? We're assuming that he came to empower us to witness. He didn't say that. He says the Spirit of God came to empower us to be witnesses. In other words, you're supposed to represent and be proclaiming truth by who you are, by how you live, as well as by what you say. There should never be a distinction between what you say and what you're doing, what you say and what you're like. That's powerful. How many times have you heard, you know, his walk just doesn't match his talk? Well, that just tells me he's not being filled with the Spirit. When you're filled with the Spirit, your walk will match your talk.
You know, Dale, John 16, you know, I talked a lot about, and for me that was such an epiphany verse when Jesus says, "I'm going to leave," and it's actually to your advantage that I leave. I know you and I've had that conversation many times, but you really don't stop to think about if we just take Jesus for what he's saying here, how could it be to man's advantage, to the apostles' advantage, that they not reside with Christ? What could be more advantageous than that? Well, according to Jesus, right, and dwell with the Holy Spirit is. And we're just kind of glossed over that in a lot of our congregations and not really given that the due that it was due, I think.
I think that's a good word. Somehow today, we're in a better state than if Jesus was here walking among us. Now, that's important to meditate on.
That's what he says.
And if you look at the apostles' lives after he left, they were totally different. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were strong and they weren't doing all this stuff.
Yeah, exactly right. So, you know, if we wanted to consolidate all these ideas here, he basically came to continue the ministry of Jesus within the lives of each person individually. That's why it's better. See, when Jesus walked upon the earth, he had one Jesus. Now, if he's going to take the life of Jesus and put it within us so that we can flush it out and manifest to the world, we ought to see likenesses to Jesus everywhere. And isn't it interesting that the purpose of God in giving us the Spirit of God is to make us like Jesus? Romans 8:29. God is trying to make us like his Son.
that we would be conformed into the image of his son. Why? Because the son gives the greatest glory to the father. Mm-hmm. If we're like the son, we're going to be giving glory to the father. And that's also a little point of meditation. If I'm like the son, I'm not focusing on the son. I'm focusing upon the father. If I'm dwelling upon the ministry of the Spirit of God, it ought to lead me to glorifying Jesus. And when Jesus is glorified, that should lead me back up the chain to the father. Don't miss that. When the Spirit of God came in the same way as when Jesus first came on the scene, they were not trying to start a new religion. They were trying to enhance and embolden the religion that had already been revealed. So he came to continue the ministry of Jesus within the lives of each person individually. So what does it mean to be filled with the Spirit? I've always been, not always, but at times, especially in the last 25 years or so, I've been amused that I wonder why certain verses jump out at leaders in the church over, you know, over the history of the church, over the centuries. And it's interesting that this verse has jumped out. Lots of people talk about this hundreds and hundreds of years. Be filled with the Spirit. You wonder why that happened. And this is just one example. There'll be other verses that it just seems like everybody wants to make everything out of this verse. It's just most important. I believe the Bible is like Baskin Robbins. There are at least 31 flavors here, and you need to taste them all. Okay? While it's all ice cream, it's all leading and focusing on the same subject. There are different ways to view this truth, and it's going to lead you down one pathway. But it's not vanilla. It's not just one flavor. Why does the Holy Spirit come? What does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit? To be filled with the Holy Spirit is to be controlled and empowered by the Holy Spirit. You see, the word fill comes is a nautical term that we're going to look at in just a moment. And Paul picks out a word that's perfect in his time to describe what God is doing in a person's life. Now, remember, when you're controlled and empowered by the Holy Spirit, the ministry of the Spirit of God is to take from Jesus and give it to us. And so you should be asking, well, wait a minute. What is he taking from Jesus? What is he giving to us? In this case, it is his life. It is Jesus' life that he gives to the Spirit to give to us. That's pretty awesome. Well, for some reason, there you go. Here's a quote by Bill Bright. The Spirit-filled life is the Christ-filled life. When a Christian is filled with the Holy Spirit, he is filled with Jesus Christ. He no longer thinks of Christ as one who helps to do some kind of Christian task, but rather Jesus Christ does the work through a Christian. You know, I've illustrated this of the proverbial Boy Scout who helps the little old lady across the street. You know, when she's standing on the street corner, she's just barely able to stand up, much less get across the street. So the Boy Scout runs out there dutifully and, you know, either puts his arm around her or has her hold onto his shoulder or his arm, and he helps her across the street. That is not the Christian life. The Christian life is, what if the life of that Boy Scout could somehow permeate that older lady's whole being. And then what if she were able to move with his energy, with his strength, with his vitality? She would experience a different life, wouldn't she? That's what we're talking about. And by the way, that's what the word inspired portrays in English. When you're inspired, something has come into you to create new meaning, to create more motivation. The interesting thing is the Greek word for that is not really inspired, it's expired. It's a breathing out, not a breathing in. The Word of God is inspired. What do we mean? When God gave us this book, it's as though He blew the words on the page. The exact words He wanted, He led the authors of Scripture to write. So the Spirit-filled life is the Christ-filled life. It's all about His life. Now, guys, I want you to think about this. So what is the Spirit of God taking from Jesus to give to us? Life. Jesus' life is eternal life. It is this life He came to give us abundantly. The power that the Holy Spirit gives is actually the life of Jesus. When we talk about power, we don't really want to focus or limit the concept just to strength, to be strengthened, because we want to add virtue, we want to add wisdom, we want to add strength all together in this life. So whatever Jesus was, He gave to us, of course not His deity. I'm not talking about that, but I am talking about His communicable attributes. He gave to us to display back to the world His life. Jesus wants you to be before He wants you to do. He wants you to be something different by the life the Spirit of God instills within you before you start being a worker bee for Jesus. We've got worker bees for Jesus that aren't working with His life. They're working with their own life. I see that look.
That's just a great word. That's just a great word. You know, when Blackaby's experience in God came out, that's really kind of the cornerstone foundation of what Blackaby's saying. We have this tendency to pray about, well, you know, should I do this and should I do that, and you know, what about this and this and this, and Blackaby's saying, turn that around. Just abide and see what He is leading you to do instead of trying to get Him that answer where you're leading us.
That's so right on. And we need to really grasp that. Because, you know, quite frankly, let's be honest, the Christian life is a fairly high standard, isn't it? What if you try to meet that high standard year after year after year in your own strength? Finally, you say, I can't do it. I tried. It's boring, it's lifeless, I'm out of here. I'm giving up, I'm throwing the towel in. I believe that so many young people, when they go to college, you know, we talk about losing their faith. No, they never learned this. Their faith was all about them being obedient to a standard of do's and don'ts. Mm-hmm. And they finally say, boy, that's tough. I just, you know, I can't pull it off. And what we've got to do is say, God never expected you to do it. He always wanted you to walk by faith. In the Old Testament, just trusting Him. But in the New Testament, you've gotten you've been given new resources with the life of Jesus. Now he wants this life to literally come back upon the earth and flow through you to manifest to the world. Be before you do. Because if you don't, I know this is very hard to grasp. If you are committed to doing the right thing, the moral, the godly thing, but you don't have Christ's life to do it, it's not really godly, even though it's still the right thing to do. Godliness comes from the life of Christ flowing through you. So why is the average Christian not filled with the Holy Spirit? Now, there are a lot of reasons. I'm just going to name a few. A lack of knowledge. Quite frankly, this isn't a concept that's really taught very often.
Yeah. So just parsing words here for a second with the word filled. So you've got a believer. They've trusted Jesus. And so when we say filled with the Holy Spirit, really, you got as much spirit in any one believer as you have in another, do you not, theoretically?
No.
So when we say filled, is that really what we're trying to say?
Well, you're going to have to give me a moment because we're going to hit that very topic. When you're filled with the Spirit, not about being filled with the Holy Spirit himself. He's the agent that fills you. Just like when you go to the gas station and you fill your car. Well, you didn't fill your car. You know, you pump gas into it. You're the agent that puts something else into the car. The Spirit of God is the agent that puts something else into me. We're going to see what that is in just a moment.
Then to stay with that analogy, you got to be refilled all the time.
Yeah.
Right.
Lack of knowledge. We're just not taught this. I'm a very slow, long-term student. So with my 14 years of seminary training, I didn't have one class on this topic. Uh-oh. How am I supposed to teach it if there's nobody there to teach me what to teach? Well, praise God, I learned it before I went to seminary by others who understood it. And I can remember sitting in the classroom with people chafing, at least to my right at this one particular time, and he's just saying, I don't know why we have to learn this. I don't know why we have to be in here. And I'm sitting here with just 2 years of ministry experience saying, oh, let me share with you after class. It just gives you a different perspective. But this knowledge isn't being taught today. The do's and don'ts are being taught. But the being is assumed. If you're a Christian, we're assuming that you're the right person. And that's a bad assumption. Secondly, pride. You know, it's almost like Nahum. Remember Nahum in the Old Testament? The military leader that had leprosy? He really wanted a solution, but there's no way in the world he's going to go dip himself 7 times in that muddy, yucky river. If you've been to Israel, the Jordan River can look pretty bad during the rainy season. He's just not going to go dunk himself. And finally, this little Jewish slave girl said, that's fine. You want to be healed, but dunk yourself. You don't want to be healed. Just, you know, let your pride keep you from jumping in that water. I don't know if he thought about it or, you know, under duress he went, but he eventually got in the water and dunked himself. And that 7th time, completely clean. And then guess what? He had a new vision of God. This is the God. The God of Israel is the right God. Ah, don't let pride keep you from this. You're not capable in yourself. You may be highly educated, inherently smart, strong, or even virtuous. It's not enough. God is saying, I've called you to participate in a program that you're not capable of accomplishing. That's why the whole program is a faith walk. Fear. Sometimes we just are afraid what God's going to do. You know, I don't want to lose what I got. I don't want to, you know, take this too far. I don't want to be a fanatic. There are a lot of reasons. I can remember some people don't go in the ministry when God is clearly leading them to ministry. Why? Well, there's that fear of what if he leads me to what if he leads me to some impoverished part of the world? My comment is, the will of God never takes you beyond what the grace of God can sustain. So if he leads you there, trust me, you're going to see the hand of God in a way that others won't be able to see it. Follow his leading, whatever that is. Could be a secret sin. Sometimes we have things in our lives that we really don't want to give up. Like it. We want to keep doing it. And we know it's wrong. But we want to keep doing it. Sometimes it's just being worldly minded. You know what? Life's good. And if I have to get really serious about my walk, I'm going to have to give up certain things. And I don't want to do that. And lots of times it just all comes down to a lack of trust in God. We don't really believe that God is good. We don't really believe he works all things together for good. And by the way, I'm not trying to be harsh or ugly here. But when the negative things happen, do you still believe that God's working all things together for good? Or do all of a sudden you start wondering and chafing at that moment? When things are good, oh, God's good. But things are getting very stressful and heavy. Is he still good? Because we don't believe in God and trust in God, we're not filled with the Spirit. So how is one filled with the Spirit? Here's coming back to answer your question, Times. Paul is using a nautical concept here. Filling is really nautical. It's going to set before you the difference between a rowboat and a sailboat. Most Christians are in a rowboat rowing. Have you ever been in a rowboat rowing? I can remember in my early, early years, I went fishing with my uncle who was raising me. And we got caught out on a lake when a storm came up. And we saw the storm coming, but, you know, we didn't have much time to fish. So we were going to fish. And all of a sudden, we got caught in that storm, and the winds were so strong. And it wasn't a humongous lake, but it was big enough that it was kind of hard to get to the shore. It was very hard, and the winds were blowing so strong that the wave—it was just a little bitty normal fishing boat, you know, if you rowed. There was no motor, and so my uncle unfortunately had asthma. I wasn't good because he could only row for so long, and then he would be completely out of breath, and when he was catching his breath, the wind just pushed it right back to where we were coming from, you know, in the middle of the lake, seemed like. So I had to help, and it was just really, really hard. But a sailboat, all it has to do is adjust the sails to catch the wind. What do you think a good word for that, when the sails are adjusted to catch the wind, the sail is filled with wind? And you know what's interesting? The same Greek word for wind is the word for spirit. So to be filled and empowered by the Spirit of God is that nautical concept that Paul had in his mind on the Sea of Galilee. When the storms had come up very quickly, and you get in that little boat with a little bitty sail, big enough for 12 to 14, 15, 16 guys, and that adjust that sail. And guess what? You think about it, rarely can you adjust the sail and go straight. If there's a storm and there's a headwind, you've got to tack, don't you? Back and forth to make progress to get there. But what, sometimes we get really out of sorts with God because we want this to get over. We want to be finished with this. We want to move on with our life. And God says, I'm giving you a chance to tack back and forth in this trial that you have. If you're making progress, if you're trusting me, if you're adjusting your sail. But you need to know what you need to have. You need to know what you need to have at a given moment to be filled with the Spirit. So we must adjust our sails to catch the wind. Are we at the point of seeing our needs? What is it that you're struggling with? What is the trial before you? To go forward, you need to sail. If you're going to row, remember that the concept here is rowing against the current with a headwind. That's hard rowing. That's the normal life. And you see people that are just burnt out with their faith. So they start getting lukewarm and then cold. We need to discern what we need so that we can adjust our sails. The admission of each need is an adjustment of the sails to catch the wind. Lord, I'm really stressed. I need your peace. Adjust that sail. Catch the wind. Be moved along. Don't depend upon yourself to just kind of handle the circumstance. God provided the Spirit of God and the life of Jesus to move you along. When God is all we have, we find that He is all we need. Isn't it too bad that He has to take us to that place before we realize that simple truth? You see, so many times God has to take away from us things that we depend upon so that only He is left. But if I don't turn to God at that moment, I start complaining and grumbling against God. You've taken away everything I've got. And God said, I did that so you would come to me for me to provide. Two words make this concept of the filling of the Spirit very, very easy. Just two little words. Very simple, very easy to remember. One is a command. We're going to look at Ephesians 5:18 in detail now. And the other is a promise that He's given us. I think Crew and the founder and president, Bill Bright, who's now with the Lord, had the simplest presentation of this you can have. Can you go deeper? Absolutely. Which I don't think you can get better. Deeper doesn't necessarily mean better. So, how is one filled with the Holy Spirit? Two words help make this easy. Command. In Ephesians 5:18, it says, and don't be drunk with wine, for that's dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. For the last 30 years or so, I've asked people to quote me Ephesians 5:18, and I have yet to have anybody quote it properly. Not one time. And I don't want to be ugly, but some of our translations make it very difficult to quote it properly because they leave verses out. What version?
This is New King James.
Well, that's God's word. But the NIV messes with you. It leaves out a very important word. The first word. And you're saying, well, big deal. And my question is, anybody a little grammar friendly here? What kind of conjunction is and?
Means there's something else.
It's what?
Another condition.
Something else. Well, you've got conjunctions that are subordinating and conjunctions that are coordinating. This is a coordinating conjunction. That means it's joining two things of equal rank. So before I jump into Ephesians 5:18, I really need to know what's in 5:17. What's 5:17 say, guys?
Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is.
The filling of the Spirit is not to guide you, to advise you, to tell you what the will of God is. You have to already know the will of God before you're filled. It's not God's way of, you know, leading you. The leading of the Spirit is something different. He's not going to somehow tell you what you don't know that you should know. Do not be drunk with wine, for that's dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. The and tells you, I better have my mind in gear. God does not bless an empty head. He wants that head filled with his will. Okay, now trick question. Okay, I want you to answer it as quickly as you can. I don't want you to think. Fill it. It's a fill in the blank. Are you ready? The will of
God.
I would have said exactly the same thing. That's not what verse 17 says, though, is it? It's the will of the Lord. How is Jesus the Lord of your life? I've got to first of all have my mind set upon his will. I've got to know it. When it says don't be foolish, the word don't be foolish, that's a command, by the way, in this passage, as well as this being a command. That really looks at a thinking process that forms settled convictions rather than just not thinking about things and being foolish. Hey, slow down to think. Think and think deeply so that you form convictions. That's the word that's used here. Talks about the mind focused, forming convictions. So be that kind of person. Think, have convictions. We need to understand the difference between knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Knowledge is knowing facts, truth. It could be one after the other. They could be disassociated. It's just lots of stuff. But wisdom is taking each one of those facts and applying it to life. Okay, fill in the blank. And I want you to answer very quickly. What's the opposite of wise? Quickly.
Unwise.
You read the verse. It's being foolish, most people would say. Not in this context. The opposite of wise is unwise. Look at verse 16. 15. Be careful. Understand what the... I'm sorry. I'm having trouble bringing it back. Someone quote that for me.
17 is, therefore do not be unwise.
No, 15.
15. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise.
Okay. That's not exactly what it says. It says, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise. Okay, not as unwise. But in other words, he says, you know what you're learning? It's great that you're learning. But if you're not applying it to life, what you're learning is useless. Apply it to life. What is God saying that you need to do with this truth that you're learning? But understanding is even bigger. Understanding is like multiplying wisdom. Knowledge is knowing truth. Wisdom is taking that truth and applying it to your circumstance. But understanding is, hey, you know what? That truth doesn't just apply here. It applies there and there and there. And I want you to pull all that together and see how it all fits. I want you to be meditating. I want you to be men and women who meditate upon God's truth. Why? John 17:17 says, Jesus is praying to the Father, sanctify them, Lord. Sanctify them. Boy, my mind is just going blank. Sanctify them in truth. Thy word is truth. So, the first command, be filled with the Spirit, that's an imperative, it's a command, and it's a present tense. It means be continuously being filled. It's not a once for all thing. It's repetitive. Be being filled. In other words, keep your sails adjusted to the wind so it's always filled. And you've got to discern, oh, you know, the wind seems to be changing direction. Or I've now tacked out here so far I need to come back. You're constantly discerning the needs that you have so you can adjust your sails.
What do you think he's implying by the juxtaposition of being drunk with wine against filled with Spirit?
I think he's referring to the Ephesians and their part of their religious belief had to do with the god of wine. Help me out. It's pronounced something like Bacchol. Yes. They would get drunk in their festivals. Mm. He said, I want you to think about that. When you're drunk, what's taking place in your life? Aren't you really kind of controlled by the substance that you just consumed? Mm. He says, in that same way, if you adjust your sails right, you're controlled by the Spirit of God and what He provides.
So this was not so much about drunk with wine, just in the simple sense, it had to do with the context of the way the Ephesians.
Yeah. It would have been very poignant for them.
I see another connection, though, that had never occurred to me until you mentioned verse 17. When you're drunk, you're uninhibited.
You're what?
Uninhibited. It lowers your inhibition. And if you don't know the will of God first, then you're going to get in trouble. Because if you lower your inhibitions, you're very susceptible to any spiritual force. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I agree. I don't think that's its main point, because it just never occurred to me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you could go to 1 John 4. 1-4, especially verse 4, for that concept too. Is it God's will for you to be filled with the Spirit? How do you know? What if you've been thinking along with the Apostle Paul? My God, he just commanded us to be filled. He just said, excuse me, and an imperative, be being filled. Be filled. Do it now and keep doing it. Being filled is not a once-for-all activity. Guys, listen to me. Because that's true, we should not be talking about, quote, a Spirit-filled person, end quote. I don't know if he's filled with the Spirit at any given moment. If he's trusting the Spirit of God to do what he needs, to supply what he needs, then he's filled. But it's not something that just automatically goes from situation to situation. You can be filled with the Spirit in reference to one situation, and then another situation come in immediately on the heels of that, and you're not filled because you don't adjust your sails, because you don't see your need, you don't adjust your sails to receive from the Spirit of God what you need in the new situation. You just respond naturally. God doesn't want you to respond naturally. He wants you to respond by having your mind set up on His will, and you first ask, Lord, what do you say about this? So you are requiring me to be this kind of person. So I can respond this way to my circumstance. I need to adjust my sail. I'm not that kind of person naturally. I'm not going to give that response naturally. So it all takes place right up here in the mind. And if you look through this passage from 15, verses 15, Ephesians 5, 15 to 21, especially 15 to 18, you'll see a lot of words for the mind. Focusing on the mind. You never put your mind in neutral. If you're not thinking properly, you cannot be spiritual.
You know, Dale, I'm reminded of, I think, one of the most beautiful prayers that Paul wrote in his epistles is Colossians 1. It's just so well done. And he's praying that they would be filled with the knowledge of the will of God. And why is he doing that? So that all of these other things will happen.
Right.
So to verse 17, this is Paul's intent, that you be filled with this knowledge of the will of God, because what comes out of that, and I'll throw it up here, is that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing Him, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to His glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering and joy, giving thanks to the Father who qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. I mean, that's a great list.
Colossians 1.
That's 1, 9 through 12. 12.
Yep. So the command in Ephesians 5:18 is what it is. God's command. So how do you know He wants to be filled? He's commanding you to be filled. We know that's His will. So the second word is promise. In John, 1 John 5:14 and 15, the Apostle John says this, and this is the confidence which we have before Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. Okay, well, what was His will? Be filled with the Spirit. And if we know that He hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request which we've asked from Him. So, He wants me to be filled. If you seek this filling, you know you're going to have it. If you ask God to fill you with the Spirit, will He? Of course He will. How do you know? Because He promises in 1 John 5:14 and 15 to answer your request and fill you with the Spirit. You may not hear angels sing when you make that prayer. You may not feel different all over. Doesn't matter. It doesn't have to do with feelings. It has to do with trusting in the trustworthiness of God and His Word. It's about your faith, not about your feelings. So, looking at spirituality versus maturity, spirituality is immediate. Maturity is a process, the length of which varies dramatically. I can't emphasize that enough. Usually what we do today is we think about a mature person being that white-haired man who's in his 90s. He sits on the front row of the church, on the front row pew of the church, and he knows what the pastor's going to say before he says it. And, you know, he not only does he know it, he lives it. He's just a godly man. Well, he may be mature, but that's not what the Bible talks about being mature. Paul says that within 4 to 6 years, you ought to go from being a new believer in Christ to a mature believer in Christ. 4 to 6 years. Now, guys, think about this. If it takes 4 to 6 years for you to be a mature person, How long should it take you to deal with one issue that you may be having? Just a thought. You know, what we're doing is, the way we counsel today, we're giving so much slack that people have their whole life. That, you know, God's working on me. Just be patient. Hey, you know what? You're way past his due date. Okay, now you're in a spoiled area. Behavior change can be instant. You can do this. Let's say anger. You became angry. You can change your anger to a calm, peaceful, patient response instantly. You don't need to count to 10. You don't need time to, you know, regroup. Most of us take all that. I do, unfortunately. I don't need it. Galatians 5, 16, and 17 says, if I walk by the Spirit, I'll not carry out the desires of the flesh. What's the desire of the flesh? Anger. Be angry. So in the midst of my problem, in the midst of my anger, if I choose to rely upon the Spirit of God, I can stop my behavior and change it. But character change is not like behavior change. Character change may take some time. But that's a totally different issue. If you will have behavior change going on over time, the character change will happen eventually with it. Guys, let me explain something to you that just I saw some years ago and it just excites you. Yeah, isn't it true that you've got some people that you walk into and they're just something about their life? They're magnetic, they're enthusiastic, there's something alive about them. You know how you become a joyful person? Not experiencing joy, but a joyful person? By rejoicing always. If I start rejoicing and I keep rejoicing, eventually, God transforms me into that kind of person. Same way with the rest of the virtues. If I'm loving, and I start loving, and I keep loving, you know what? I become a loving person. God transforms my character into the image of Jesus. That's pretty astounding. Here are some truths to treasure. If you have already believed in Jesus, the Holy Spirit already dwells in you. Being filled is not a once-for-all experience. It must reoccur. In fact, it must reoccur most likely scores and scores and scores of times every day. Okay? So it's not once-for-all. We are filled by faith. We're taking God at his word, and we're trusting him and his word. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. You must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. The Holy Spirit will enable us to perform the obedience that we can't carry out by ourselves, and to experience the virtue that we can't produce ourselves. Filling has to do with performance, doing. But before performance is done, it's preceded by empowerment, being. He wants you to be before you do. So let's be filled. Here's how you'd be filled, or here's how I'm going to teach it in the conference. I'm going to ask someone to give me his schedule. I want your daily schedule. What would it be like today or next week? Then I'm going to ask, what is to be done at each point in your schedule? I want the list of things you're responsible for, the list of people that you're going to be involved with.
Now, it's up to you to discern what's taking place and what the needs are. God said, I gave you a mind. Sit there and think. Well, I don't like that person. Oh, good. That's a good place to start. So somebody's going to be in that meeting that you don't like. Or, well, I'm not as prepared as I need to be. Ah, that's good. So I'm discussing and uncovering my needs. Now I need to discover what God wants to provide from His Word based upon my needs. God can't prepare the unprepared. In a business meeting, if you're unprepared, He's not going to somehow magically give you a plan that's going to satisfy the board. Not happening. But He can give boldness to be truthful. We trust Him to work in and through us for His glory. After I find out what He wants to do in my circumstance for that day, each step of the way, I'm going to trust Him to work in me, providing to me what I need, and through me as I use what He provides. Guys, the bottom line is we must never lose sight of His purpose for us. I'm not here to do a business deal. I'm here to represent God. I'm here to be an ambassador for Christ. Okay? If the business deal goes through and it does look fantastic. God just put icing on the cake. But if people respond to the way that you respond, that's better. That's the home run already. So if we simplify this, we simply say, obtain God's will from God's Word. Remember that faith is always involved and that all we need has already been provided. Everything has already been provided. But we must draw it upon it. We must draw it up by faith, believing that God has given the virtue, wisdom, and power to respond, and that God wants to use our obedience to accomplish ends we can't accomplish. So let's pray. Father, thank you for the fact that you've given us the provisions in your Son. Your Spirit will bring those into our lives in such a way that we will be able to live the very life of Jesus. Help us to understand that it's not our capabilities, it's not our training that really matters. What matters is how we respond to the circumstance before us, so that you might receive glory, so that your will might be done, and in the end, we might hear from you, well done, my good and faithful servant. Thank you, Father, for the privilege of life. Equip us that we might not only be successful in handling the trials and difficulties of life, but bring you glory in the process. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Good job, Dave.
That's good.
I assume you're going to be speaking through an interpreter. Mm. No?
There are. Unlike America, unlike me, they know England.
They do? Oh, good.
Hey, Dale.
Yeah.
Tom Passmore said, how do we measure or become aware of spiritual transformation? How do we measure or become aware of spiritual transformation?
Well, that'd be like asking, when do I know I'm awake? You know, it's inherent. I can see my change. I can see what God is doing. And, you know, when I get to the point of being able to see it, when it's happening, it'll bring goosebumps all over you. You know, Watchman Nee, he's changed. Watchman Nee made the statement that we need to learn to live a detached life. A detached life is, it's not about me. I'm involved, but I'm detached. Have you ever had deja vu? You know, you walk into this place and say, I swear I've been here before. This, I mean, you were sitting right there, and you were sitting right there. This has happened before. The goal is for us to see all of life as deja vu. In other words, when I come and sit down, I'm here to do what God is calling me to do, but it's so not about me. It's like I can step back from this chair and watch the whole thing, me included. I can step back and watch me, and I'm just in one sense I'm passive. I'm an observer. I'm detached from the situation. Why? Because God is at work, God is providing, God is impacting. But guess what? He is using me. So I'm not completely passive. I'm the agent, but it's like a conduit rather than it all depends upon me. He pours in this broken vessel and it seeps out the sides probably, but it still goes through the right place. So so you know, for me, I've learned that if God doesn't give me an answer, well, stop talking. You know, you don't need an answer.
I would add to that, although it is a very lofty and high standard that Paul defined it pretty well in Philippians 4. Mm-hmm. I've learned to be content in all circumstances. I have no needs. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So, you know, if we're looking for a litmus test, if that is how we are working through whatever situation we're in, it's not possible to do that without being filled.
Well, let me share this one thought with you. That you remember John Seibold? I'm actually taking my, after we get done, I'm taking my income back down to Seibold Dodging. When John was in the hospital, that he wouldn't leave alive, or in this earthen way. I was visiting the day before he died, or 2 days before he died. I said, and we were always talking about the spirit-filled life. I said, John, how do you know when you're filled with the Spirit? No, I thought I knew. But John put it in a way that just, it just made me burst into tears. And he's from his, literally his deathbed, and he said, oh, Dale, that's so easy. All right, come on, bring it up. There's no more self involved. There's no more self involved. It's all about the Spirit. And when he said it, if you knew John, you knew that's exactly how he lived. That's the kind of man who walked. There was just no self. That's amazing. That's what I'm trying to communicate here. It's hard for us, even in our learning, because we feel like we're so capable. I'm so capable of doing this stuff. I've been trained. I've had on-the-job experience, and you know, lots of other. We're so capable when God says, can't deal with the self here. I'm asking you to just fill me with the life of Jesus, not my life, not my abilities, his life, and let it flow through me. I'm trusting constantly that happens. And John, just the epitome of that. Dale, it's easy. You're filled with the Spirit, but there's no more self. Do you have to have it your way? Do you have to have it go in this direction? Do you have to have these kinds? You're not filled with the Spirit. If it's, you have that contentment. So, in that sense.
Yeah, I think in the sense of what he's asking, the only real metric is when you're aware that your responses have changed. Mm-hmm. You know, you she would respond differently to the same situation. Respond in faith instead of responding.
And since faith is mental, it's not ethereal, I know when I'm responding in faith. All right, guys.